I have received notice from the Minister of Finance that he wishes to make a statement. Minister.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to make a statement on a rates rethink spurring economic growth. A new tapakishja bart a wulugum a wulshemar I make a new koruyanu or elementary in chira ogus or elementary tractala and chorus ratala dun spragu yanu or in gallagher marwonus or hockey rinsha ogus rahul. A shade shaw mawalti a concordia mar aragirish ogus tamay a sul the gologoria fuhu leshin koshja aragirish the makulaki as an aimus ogus or noya leshin fobble a kuchinya. Today, Mr. Speaker, I am proposing a groundbreaking package of measures aimed at modernising both the domestic and commercial elements of the rating system in order to stimulate the economy as the foundation of a shared and prosperous society. These are my proposals as Finance Minister, and I look forward to consulting on them with the Finance Committee, of course, with my colleagues in the Executive and with the wider public. Taken together, the package constitutes the biggest shake-up in rating policy in a generation, and signals my commitment to a tax system that is fair and that supports prosperity. Rates are a vital source of public revenue. Money raised through rates funds our schools, our hospitals and other essential services. My aim in setting out these proposals, therefore, is to ultimately arrive at a refreshed, fit-for-purpose rating system in which citizens and commercial ratepayers contribute according to their ability to funding the building of a modern, inclusive, exemplary society. I also intend to ensure that rates act more as an economic spur. The rate system should encourage regeneration, investment and entrepreneurship, and at the same time discourage dereliction and decline. Let me move to non-domestic rates. I will begin with the non-domestic rates proposals first. I want to replace the existing small business rate relief scheme with a £22 million investment in small retail and hospitality businesses. This move aligns with the findings of the Ulster University Economic Policy Unit's evaluation, which recommended a more targeted approach. In 2010, the Small Business Rate Relief Scheme was introduced to provide small businesses with temporary respite from the recession. The Ulster University evaluation found that the scheme had served its limited purpose, helping with cash flow at a particularly difficult time. It also found that the scheme contributed little to economic growth, and the £18 million of cost would not provide value for money in the long term. It therefore recommended replacing the SBRR with a more targeted initiative. I want to target this support under this new scheme at those sectors which are key to the survival of our town and city centres. The statistics show, Concordia, that the town centre retail spending is down 10% since the beginning of the century. I would like this new initiative to be easily accessible for small businesses, subject to some simple tests around business investment in the form of, for example, new equipment, skills training or the employment of additional staff. In the time ahead, I would also like to enable companies to access this rates relief by accrediting with the Living Wage Foundation. Small business empowerment zones. I also wish to bring forward a business empowerment zone pilot targeted at small-scale regeneration areas and developed in tandem with other government departments and initiatives. I propose to start in Belfast with two pilots, the Falls and Newton Arch Roads, both areas in need of a greater peace dividend. The West Belfast zone, with special rates relief to encourage business and investment, is likely to stretch from Castle Street through the Gaeltacht Quarter to the bottom of the White Rock Road. The East Belfast zone is likely to stretch from the bottom of the Newton Arch Road through the area now the focus for the East Side Arts Renaissance, and I know C.S. Lewis Square was tonight, Mr. Speaker, to the Hollywood Arches. These will be confirmed in due course. Having worked extensively and having had the pleasure of working extensively in both areas, I know the will is there to transform these key arterial roads, and that a small amount of investment now can reap dividends for years to come. Another way to revitalise town centres is to make them vibrant living spaces. Therefore, I would also like to take forward a new scheme to incentivise conversion from commercial to residential occupation, providing a rates incentive for the first occupiers of newly converted premises in our town and city centres. A scheme to encourage people to live in these areas will help stimulate a nighttime economy and assist with issues around footfall that were raised during the consultation period. The issue of charity shops, Mr. Speaker. Another issue concerns the treatment of charity shops. This is a matter where we are striving to get the balance right. Charity shops help to bring people into our high streets or small towns, in particular when times are tough. So we need to make sure we don't upset the healthy retail mix that exists in many areas. I am in favour, all in favour, of continuing to single out charity shops on the high street for favourable treatment, but I do think there is a case for limiting their growth. We cannot have our high streets just made up of charity shops. In England, Scotland and Wales, most are charged at 20% rates, and local authorities in the south can also charge charity shops on the high street. If, for example, we reduce support for charity shops on the high street from 100% to 90%, that is, they paid one-tenth of the rate bill, that would only represent a small revenue gain for the executive. However, it would move us towards the balance principle that everyone on the high street should start to pay something. This was the strong view reflected in the small business rate relief evaluation. I agree with that direction of travel, with the caveat that I would like to see any future income from charity shops on the high street go towards supporting entrepreneurship in the social enterprise sector. I look forward to consulting further on this issue. To move on to empty property rates, I would like to address the issue of empty property. Currently, an empty property pays zero rates for 3 months and 50% thereafter. I want to increase the empty property rate from 50% to 75% of the occupied rate. This remains substantially below what is charged in Scotland, for example, where owners are charged 90% on empty properties, and recognises that our local property market is less buoyant than there. But I would also like to remove the initial exemption period of 3 months. I don't think it's necessary, it doesn't apply to the domestic sector and leads to complications in administering it. It is my view that this will encourage the letting of empty properties and increase economic activity. This will, of course, provide additional revenue for the executive, although more importantly, it will act as a stimulus for landlords holding empty property to sell up or offer lower rents and get properties occupied by business. Aligned with this objective, I am proposing to introduce the rating of empty factories, a class of property that has never been subject to rates, as well as bringing in extra money, up to $2.2 million a year, into the executive's finances, into the public purse. It will encourage owners to subdivide or let empty factories. It will also remove any doubt about what's a warehouse and what's a factory. Coupled with both these changes, I will be moving forward with proposals for anti-avoidance measures, making landlords liable for rates when they let their premises out to charities on short-term agreements. Industrial derating, at a cost of almost £60 million, at a cost of £58 million, industrial derating is a very generous support to the manufacturing sector. But manufacturing is a vital part of our economy, providing well-paid jobs, often in locations where employment opportunities are lacking, and it is highly export-oriented. Given this and the challenging economic circumstances faced, I intend to maintain industrial derating. Mines, however, a measure I'd like to remove is the new mines 7-year exemption that has been in place since 1852. I see no good reason for retaining the new mines exemption. Halls of residence. I also wish to remove the university halls of residence exemption that was put in place in 2007 by direct rule ministers. This step has already been consulted upon, and it will ensure consistency of treatment between those managed privately and those managed by universities. Indeed, all other students living away from home pay some rates, so indeed this is only fair. Furthermore, I do not believe it will inhibit the viability of the new purpose-built halls of residence. Student demand is outstripping supply, as the appearance of so many privately run halls testifies. If evidence emerges that university halls of residence need an additional incentive, then I'll be happy to return to this issue and to look at this issue again. Hardship relief. We are moving towards a system, Mr. Speaker, that widens the tax base and shares the load. However, many businesses find themselves in serious hardship for matters completely outside their control and beyond normal business risk. victims of flooding are one example. I do not want to see those who find themselves in hardship in such circumstances being closed down because they simply can't pay their rates bill. The legislative apparatus already exists for hardship relief, but few businesses benefit from it. I have therefore asked my officials to review the operation of this scheme to ensure that it provides help for more of those in need. A revaluation, a clear response to the calls from the business sector, is my intention to commence a new non-domestic revaluation exercise to take effect in 2019. Coming only 4 years after the revaluation in 2015, this will make our non-domestic rating system more responsive to changes in the wider world, allow it to flex with economic conditions, and help avoid the shocks which occurred last time round. As before, the process will be revenue neutral. The objective of this measure, and indeed this whole package, is about balancing the tax base, balancing the rates burden, and balancing the books after a hard time for both business and government finances. I would also like to reassure businesses by enshrining in law revaluations every 4 years. This happens in many advanced economies throughout the world. As for the level of the regional rate that will be set as part of the budget, in recognition of the new era for local government, I would like to give councils the choice of striking their own non-domestic district rate, thereby breaking the historic link that exists with the domestic district rate. Such a move could help councils attract new business and retain old ones. To domestic rates, fairness underpins much of what I am presenting today, Mr. Speaker, and this extends to the domestic rating system. When the capital value system was being designed, it was designed on the basis that you paid in direct proportion to the value of your home. However, the application of the £400,000 cap means that those in houses with a higher value pay proportionately less than those in middle or lower value homes. This to me is inherently unfair. Take the house of Bill Gates, and I know many people would like to take the house of Bill Gates, but take Bill Gates' house. He pays $1 million a year on property tax on his $100 million Washington State home. If he lived here, the rates on that home would be less than $5,000 a year. There are significant measures already in place to safeguard the elderly pensioner who is asset-rich but income-poor and remaining in a high-value family home. We have a generous low-income rate relief scheme which was put in place before the cap came along. In a phased introduction, I wish to charge a regional rate levy, approximately 55% of the rates due on a property, to the full value of a home in order to raise an additional £4 million in revenue. Additionally, Mr. Speaker, in relation to the early payment discount, the first thing I'd like to do in terms of domestic rates is reduce and then remove the early payment discount. I will be reducing the allowance to 2% in the context of the budget settlement, and will then be consulting on the proposal for the removal of the revision altogether. The £6 million this measure costs the public purse cannot be justified in these difficult financial times. Energy-efficient new homes. As with the business rate system, I want the domestic rating system to incentivise good behaviour. I have asked my officials to consider reopening the low-carbon new home scheme and refashioning it as an energy efficiency incentive by providing an extended domestic rates holiday for the first occupants of new houses that meet the required standard, thus also helping our construction sector. This needs more research into the standards and value for money, but this work is already underway. Finally, but not insignificantly, I want the advance proposals to significantly reduce the landlord allowance paid to all landlords in the public and private sectors. This was the subject of consultation, and I intend to reduce it to 5%. Derelict property levy. What I have outlined today, Mr. Speaker, are the immediate challenges. Looking beyond that, research is well underway into developing a levy on derelict property. We, with the help of the councils, have already identified 1,800 problem properties, and I have commissioned the Economic Policy Centre at UU to provide us with independent policy advice. I recognise there are a range of reasons for which derelict properties are lying vacant, and we need to be sensitive to this so that we don't hinder orderly development activity. However, a policy is well designed, discerning. It would help encourage regeneration of and investment in our urban areas, areas that have become blighted by properties that are simply lying idle. It could also serve to increase the supply of development land for housing. In conclusion, all in all, the changes I put forward today, the package, they are driven by a need to increase the fairness of the system by ensuring that those who can contribute do so and that the tax burden is broadly shouldered. They also involve a better and more strategic targeting of reliefs to support social and economic development. And taken together, these measures will actually lead to a revenue gain for the executive and for our councils. Current estimates are up to £16 million a year recurring for the executive, money that will help deliver the executive's programme for government for all our citizens. Councils stand to gain by up to £10 million a year, and this will help them deliver better outcomes in terms of local services, as well as their new role in place shaping, building communities and economic development. Last month, in this House, I was asked by other parties in the Chamber when I would be making hard decisions in relation to rating matters. I trust you will all agree that these are hard issues that I am tackling today. The decisions I make, however, will not be made alone. I have further considerations to undertake with the general public and with the Finance Committee. I will require the agreement of the Executive and this Assembly when the required legislation needs passed. Ligan and Pakistia Mishnu Multi Ata Noktu Ogamanu, Bunus Liger Shish, the Furbertianu, or Chorus Nu Amshira, Rati Atakotram, Ayanan Aviohan or Lardinage, or Gahraha, Ogusar Malsha, a Spragan Foss or our more Rijina, Ogusar Kujuin, the Rahunas. This package of bold proposals I am setting out today establishes a solid basis for developing a modern rate system that is fair, that revitalises our city and town centres and spurs growth in our high streets, and indeed that supports prosperity. Thank you.
I call Mrs. Claire Hanna.
Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his statement. This is the first side of it, but there are some interesting and very sensible proposals. We will have to look at the numbers because there will be losers as well as winners, but I look forward to exploring that. Briefly, on lifting the domestic rates cap, and as a Social Democrat, I support the concept of levying those most able to pay, although I would prefer it to be done through income tax. This will disproportionately affect people in my constituency, many of whom are on good but modest incomes who are paying for everything. What consideration has the Minister given to some package of convergence measures as were put in place to address people affected by a rates bump after local government reform?
Well, I thank the Member for her question and for focusing on the two constituencies most affected by the removal of the rates cap would be South Belfast, which I also have an interest, and North Down. And you will note there that I talk about a phased introduction. I am very sensitive to the fact that even if someone does live in a £1 million house, that they also have to balance their books and balance their budget, and that no one would like to receive next April, for example, a dramatically increased rates bill. So we're doing two things, I think. First of all, we're saying that this is a levy, so it won't include 100% of the rates bill. It's only the 55% that we control as central government. So that's the first, I think, relief to those in larger houses. And also it's a phased introduction. We will take our time in doing this. I think it might happen over two rating periods, over 2 years. But I would say this as well. It is unfair that those who live in houses that are valued at £150,000 or £200,000, that they are subject to a regressive taxation system, which is property tax. And I look forward to the day when I, or the finance minister who follows me, controls income tax. But until that day, we need to take the decisions over the taxes that we control and over the rates that we control. And this is a decision which is timely, which will bring extra money into the coffers to deliver services, not just in South Belfast and North Down, but right across the jurisdiction. And I'm looking forward to getting the fulsome support of all the parties in South Belfast in particular and North Down for this measure.
Called Mrs. Emma Little-Pengelly.
Mr. Speaker. I welcome the statement, although I do echo the words of our fellow South Belfast constituency MLA that some will create concern within the constituency, particularly around the domestic cap. So we look forward to consulting on that and hearing the views. But as the Minister will be aware, the committee is currently examining the issue of business rates. We're taking evidence on that. We'll be out and about. We're intending to visit Portadown and Warren Point to see the situation on the ground. Will the Minister commit to coming before the committee specifically on this issue of rates during the consultation to outline in a bit more detail your thinking? But in addition to that, can the Minister, I know you referenced it in your statement, but can the Minister confirm very clearly that this represents today your thinking in relation to the direction of rates reform, and that you are intending to bring all of these proposals and whatever happens during the consultation, the revised proposals, back to the Executive for their agreement and their decision in relation to this?
Well, Madam Chairman, thank you for your question, and I know you were able to come along this morning for a short briefing on the proposals. I think, first of all, I think we need to nail our colours to the mast in relation to the removal of the cap. We're either for it or we're against it, and we then will get into the discussion of how it will be administered. And I have had the experience of politicians from another party rapping doors in my constituency of people who may be inclined to vote for me, telling them, don't vote for Martin O'Mullier, because he wants to remove the rates cap. And I hope that doesn't happen with this. And I know the member has less association with the person involved in doing that than she might. Some people might think she has. But that did happen in the past, and I think people need to nail their colours to the mast. And I hope the SDLP in particular in that light.
Point of order at the end of the Minister's statement.
Thank you. So I hope people will nail their colours to the mast, and I look forward to the day when the SDLP isn't rapping doors in South Belfast and telling people oppose Martin O'Mullier because he will remove the rates cap. I think it's fair, and I say that to the chairwoman of the committee as well. Secondly, I look forward to getting the opportunity to go into the Finance Committee, my beloved Finance Committee, and discussing business rates. I did offer that the last time, but you remember that my offer was spurned and we spent 3 hours talking about other matters. But the offer stands, and I look forward to discussing these matters with the Finance Committee. But again, I think we need to nail our colours to the mast. Do we agree with the evaluation carried out, which said the existing scheme is too broad, too diffuse, hasn't delivered any results? And do we then believe it should be replaced with a targeted approach which is focused on small retail and hospitality, which is linked to tourism? But let's be clear, these are the proposals of the Finance Minister. They need the support of this Assembly. They need the support of this Assembly. This is the ultimate authority in relation to all the proposals I lay out today. So it will be a discussion, you can be sure, with the Finance Committee. It will be a discussion with the stakeholders, and I know some of that has started already. But it will also be a concerted effort by my team to win people over, and where there are genuine concerns, we want to address them. And there will be improvements. You know, I've laid out the broad parameters here, but I have no doubt, looking at some of the very wise and sage members around here, there will be improvements of what I'm proposing in the time ahead.
Call Mr. John O'Dowd.
Thank you, Ken Crowley. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And before I move beyond South Belfast into another constituency, while quite understandably the focus will be on what rates we are raising, but I think it's also worth noting that every £1 million extra the Executive can raise, it's 30 extra teachers or 30 extra nurses. So I think the fact that the Minister is looking at proposals which actually will raise further revenue for the Executive. But I want to move to non-domestic rates and ask the Minister, in terms of the vision he sets out at the start of his statement, how will that impact in terms of towns and villages across Upper Ban and other constituencies in terms of making our towns and villages a more attractive place for small businesses to do business?
Well, I thank the member for his question. I've had the pleasure since my appointment to visit Lurgan, to visit Banbridge. I haven't been to Portadown, which I know is another large town in your constituency. But I have seen in those town centres, and particularly in fact before my appointment in Portadown, too many empty shops, too much dereliction on the high street. And it's my intention that the measures we introduce today, in concert with the Business Association, in concert with other government departments, in particular Department of Communities, that it will lead to a turnaround, that we did introduce what I refer to as a spray and pray approach. Everyone got some rates relief in 2010, but now we're trying to have a more targeted approach. We think we need to speak to the councils, because this is clearly focused on, for the first time ever, a package of rates measures which focuses on hospitality, which of course is linked to tourism. And yet for many years in this executive, we've been putting a focus on tourism, but we haven't joined up our thinking in terms of rates. So we're doing that now. So it's my hope, I'd say to Mr. O'Dowd, that this will be a spur for economic growth that will set us on a path of more prosperous town centres and more prosperous high streets. You will note, when we go through some of the detail, that it's my intention that this new targeted rates relief scheme and support scheme for retail and hospitality, that it should be a higher NAV, it should be a higher net assessed valuation for the properties, right up to £25,000. So that will bring in many of the pubs, many of the cafes, many of the retail businesses in Portadown, Lurgan and Banbridge. Probably not them all, some of the bigger ones, but it widens the net considerably and gives people a real lift in the time ahead. So I look forward to my invitation to go back to Banbridge, Lurgan and Portadown and other parts of your constituency, and I look forward to working with the business organisations and with the councils and with the other departments to make sure we all row in behind this idea to get the maximum lift from it.
Call Mr. Philip Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for your statement. And I look forward to studying in more detail at the Finance Committee, and look forward to welcoming the Minister to the committee again. Hopefully it might be a little less entertaining and more insightful than his last visit. But from his statement, it appears that obviously this is yet to be agreed by the Executive. But did the Minister not consider replicating the Scottish or English model for non-domestic or business rates by removing all SMEs from rates below maybe 10k or 6k respectively, with tapers down to even higher levels?
Well, I thank the member for his question. I don't know if my next appearance will be insightful or entertaining, but I am looking forward to getting back in. And I know the Finance Committee has a very busy agenda as well. But the member will be aware, and anyone who served longer in the Finance Committee will know, that there has been a torturous attempts at some stages to try and really get the grips with this. How do you get the balance right? That we need to raise rates to fund our services, but at the same time, we don't want rates to be punitive. We don't want them to deter our business, and that's not always easy. I have looked at the other models, and particularly you'll know that in England last year they removed rates for properties below £10,000 NAV, I think up to £500,000 businesses may have been involved in that, and they could fund that. We really couldn't afford to give people 100% rate relief at that level. We don't have the rates base, we don't have the property base. If you think, for example, the power of South East of England, the power of Heathrow Airport, the power of London, we don't have that rates base. But what I'm proposing here in terms of the businesses, the retail and the hospitality, tourism-linked businesses which fit this criteria, what I am proposing will make a real difference, and particularly those who are of an NAV of less than 10,000. I would envisage those getting 50% off their rates, and that is that's an increase on what was there previously, and will make a real difference. But I think the member, we start out on the same basis. We want to create a system which will really change the landscape for retail and hospitality. I think the way we do these particular matters, is we don't go to the executive first and they tell the assembly what to do. What I'm doing is I'm coming to the assembly. You're absolutely right, there has to be more detail. I have to go to the committee, and then I have no doubt that I will be bidding for, and I'm confident I will receive the support of executive colleagues. But we can't put the cart before the horse. I think we're going the right way about this. The figure given for us replicating what England did was we'd blow a £60 million hole in our finances, and we just can't afford to do that. But I am sympathetic to the businesses in areas, some of which you represent, the smaller towns. And you know, I've been in Cumber and Dromore and places like that where I see too many empty properties. And this will make a real difference to retail and to hospitality businesses in those areas.
Call Mr. Stephen Farrey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I do give credit to the Minister for setting out what is a very ambitious agenda. But when he talks about nailing colours to the mast around the issue of rates capping, if he checks through the Assembly voting record and executive voting record on this, he may discover that Sinn Féin are actually doing a U-turn in that regard. But specifically on the issue of the business empowerment zones, and given the current ongoing deadlock around the transfer of regeneration powers to councils, is there not a danger that we're actually sending out from the executive a very mixed and indeed contradictory and incoherent approach to how we can actually best regenerate our towns and villages and indeed cities across Northern Ireland?
Well, I thank the member for his question, resisting the temptation to oppose removing the cap, because his constituency, of course, along with mine, is the other constituency really affected by the removal of the rates cap. I thought it was really important to stop faffing around, to try and focus on actions that will result in better outcomes for our people. And for some time now, I've been dismayed by the continuing levels of unemployment and poverty in some of the areas we look at, especially in Belfast, but also some areas outside Belfast, and in particular the heart of the East and the heart of the West. And yet at the same time, I've been heartened and buoyed up by the renaissance I see in both those areas. And I did mention tonight, I think the C.S. Lewis Square opens beside the East Belfast Visitor Centre, beside the Conswater Greenway, not so far from Ballyhacklemore, which is doing very well, not so far from just before Hollywood Arches may be captured by this. So I see great opportunity, great signs of revival. And I know the member wouldn't like me to wait until we have all our ducks in a row, without striking, and in this case I am striking and trying to send out a strong message that we can make a difference by using property taxes and rates. And I believe we can do that in West Belfast, in the Falls, right up the road, and Newton Arch Road. But it needs to be done with the cooperation of other government departments. You have seen, I'm sure, in your constituency, I don't know if Bangor has just adopted a business improvement district model, but I do know the bids are starting to make a difference in Uri, in the Cathedral Quarter, in the city centre. And this, to a degree, is us taking the bid model and trying to partner West and East to make a real difference. So I look forward to the member's input in the time ahead. But like himself, I'd rather not hang around. I'd rather really come forward with some bold proposals and then let's get them enacted. It's a pilot. If it doesn't work, we'll do something else. But at least we hold our heads up and say we know these two areas haven't received the peace dividend we'd like them to receive. And today we're trying to make a real difference.
Call Mr. Jim Wells.
First of all, I can suggest to the Minister he's going to have trouble with his decision to scrap the cap on domestic rates. But there's also a very significant comment he made earlier on in his statement. He said he was abolishing the industrial derating of vacant factory premises. He will know that there are many factories in Northern Ireland where genuine attempts have been made to rent or to sell the property. But for various reasons, sometimes the property is an interface, sometimes it's a property in an industry which simply is not viable. If that individual owner of that property can show that he or she has made every attempt to sell or to rent the property, will they still have a large rate bill landing on their desks?
Well, I thank the member for his question. I don't know if he was wishing me well or giving me his best wishes or just a word of caution around removing the rate cap. Are even a warning. But I travel in hope, and I travel with some confidence. In relation to the empty factories issue, you're absolutely right. It's a conundrum. And what we have done is we have stepped back, and we have presumed that if a factory is empty, there's nothing we can do about it. The one case was brought forward by the CEO of Fermanagh OMA Council, when he used a derelict factory. And it is the opinion in that case and in other cases that, in fact, the realisation of a landlord that there's no penalty at all in sitting in an empty factory does not encourage movement, does not encourage action. But it is difficult, and it's not unlike, and you heard, the member heard me at the end of the statement referring to derelict land and tax on derelict land. And that has the same difficulties, because sometimes people say to me, look, I'm sitting on derelict land, but it's not because I don't want to sell it, I just can't get a buyer for it. So not without complexity. Not without challenges, but I would urge the member to move forward with an open mind, and if we could prove to him that in fact by introducing a tax or rates on empty factories that it would help to convert them into productive assets, I hope then we would get his support. But I think we have a fair bit of evidence gathering to do before he comes to that decision. But I hope we will proceed with an open mind as we negotiate these issues.
Call Mr. Declan McAleer.
Cara Margaret, thank the Minister for her statement. Could the Minister outline how these proposals will benefit local councils?
Well, Gordon, I got us in cash to thank the member for his question. The House will know that I'm an advocate for the local councils, and I'm an advocate for increased powers for local councils as well, which has been in the news recently. And I do believe they are great partners. We now have 11 ambitious councils with I think, very strong growth plans for the future. What this will do immediately, when the measures are implemented, it will create a nice little windfall for councils. They'll benefit with an extra £10 million, which perhaps they will use to borrow additional money, they'll use to improve their services or to invest in their council areas. It also gives councils, when you think of the money that Belfast City Council spends on the Visit Belfast Centre, and I know there are similar plans for the relocation of the visitor centre in Derry. When you think the money that Belfast City Council puts into its convention centre and its waterfront hall and other facilities, those are really focused on tourism. Those are focused on trying to grow the economy by bringing visitors in. And now we are saying to them, with the new rates relief measures, that we are also focused on hospitality. Can I also just mention one other measure announced here today for the member? That is around trying to convert some retail premises into accommodation. It still pains me when I walk through Belfast City Centre in particular that you will see above shops premises which are not used, which are just empty, which people could live in. But also some of our towns and villages, there are retail spaces which are not coming back, and they too could be converted into accommodation to have people living in the town centres or village centres, in case of Belfast City Centre. I think those are big benefits to the council, but we can really magnify those benefits and multiply them if they were to work closely with us as we move to implement these measures.
Call Mr. William Humphrey.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for the statement that he's made to the House today. Can I say that I very much welcome the review in terms of non-domestic rates for businesses, because a boost to local businesses, particularly small businesses, is vital. But can I ask the Minister, has he been in touch and liaison with Belfast City Council, the Chamber of Commerce and Belfast and Traders Associations, particularly around the two pilot schemes he mentions, the small business empowerment zones? Because I am concerned, and I've got to say it in this House, that a zone in East Belfast that runs from the foot of Newton Arch Road to Hollywood Arches, and one in West Belfast that runs from Castle Street in the city centre, the whole length of the Falls Road to the bottom of the White Rock Road, is hardly fair and equitable and really can't be compared in the reality in terms of the outcomes from both.
Well, I thank the member for his question, and I take on board the points he makes. I would say it's a pilot, so let's see will it have a dramatic impact on both those areas. I know neither is in your constituency, but if it worked, actually what I would like to do, if this worked, is to try a rural pilot. How can we get out into the villages and towns, particularly the villages? Say that I was in speaking to Kilkeel Harbour Works on Thursday night. How can we do more work around the small coastal towns and villages as well? So, you know, I think we have to. I would certainly urge the member, difficult as it may be, to approach this with an open mind, with a good heart. Let's see what the advantages are. But if there are advantages for West and East, and we learn lessons, let's roll them out into North, and heavens forbid, we might even roll them out into South as well.
Call Mr. Danny Kennedy.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. Can I ask the Minister to return to the issue of the rating, the proposed rating of empty factories, and to provide some clarification on that as to what size of factory and whether or not his proposals will include industrial units. The Minister will know that many business owners, factory owners, also own vacant units, which they at some point would hope to develop, subject to opportunities being provided for them. Will the imposition, or could the imposition, of rating charges on such units not serve as a negative to owners and reduce their ability to provide employment opportunities?
I thank the member for his question, and I come back to the word he uses, which is opportunities. I do see this as an opportunity. We have to proceed with care. We want to, as I said in the introduction to my statement, to encourage and spur economic growth. We want to discourage dereliction, but it needs to be handled carefully. Thus far, and of course, empty business units would be already liable for empty property rates, 50% rates. But thus far, we haven't got it right. There are too many places I visit where I see empty factories, which have effectively been abandoned because there's no onus on anyone to try and get the problem sorted out. So, with his support, with his help, we'll tease our way through this. But together, I believe we can seize opportunities. And one of those opportunities is bringing back into productive use empty factories, which I see across the landscape.
I call Ms. Catherine Seeley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for the details so far. Can I ask the Minister, and I know he has touched on it a little, to detail how he hopes the measures today will encourage tourism?
Well, I thank the member for her question. Well, you know, it's a fact that the Minister for the Economy has been working assiduously over recent months on a new tourism strategy. It's a matter of fact that we have invested, this executive, all parties I think have agreed to this, we've invested very strongly in our tourism infrastructure. If you think of the Goblins, if you think of the Peace Bridge, of course, which is also a piece of tourism infrastructure, if you think of Titanic Belfast, we have really made tourism, I think, the crown jewels of our proposition as a region. And yet at the same time we haven't joined up with rates policy. Therefore, when I was in Ballycastle recently, I saw at least two closed up pubs. I travelled other areas, I see, and there has been a big decline in the number of pubs in recent years for a number of reasons, also changing habits of people. But I would like to see the tourists who do come in to, for example, follow the Game of Thrones tour and they end up down in Arglass or they end up in North Antrim. I would like to see us encouraging people who want to open cafes, restaurants, pubs or other premises which might serve those people. And I did see that when I visited Port Rush at the invitation of Minister Given. We're right down on the harbour. We had the pleasure of seeing a small cafe, I believe called Babushka, and met 10 Chinese bloggers who were in having feast for their breakfast, who were in enjoying breakfast and blogging and writing about the wonders of that part of the world. What we're doing now is we're trying to join up our thinking. We know tourism is important, but now we're giving an added incentive, an added lift to those who have taken a risk and set up businesses in the hospitality sector.
Call Ms. Joanne Bunting.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to ask the Minister how he plans to address the legitimate concerns that some of us have, that far from a fair system that supports prosperity, he's penalising some small businesses for the benefit of others when they all contribute to the economy and they all employ people. So how does he propose to define retail?
Well, I thank the member for her question, and I suppose it goes back to the basis of our new thinking. In 2010, we introduced a small business rate relief scheme, which was helpful to many businesses. I'm sure many of us here know those who have those small businesses. But we're six, maybe seven, perhaps 8 years on when we introduce our new measures, I hope. And it's time for a more targeted approach. In other places where they have had to designate businesses as retail or other, they have found a way to do it. I'm confident we'll do the same. I have to say that those who will lose out will be offices. And they are important. Therefore, having supported for 7 years, for example, an average payment of £700, yes, we are moving on to a system where we're going to target our resources elsewhere. I'm actually going to spend more money. The last small business rate relief cost around £18 million and intend to spend £22 million in this. There is a lot of work here for LPS to go out and to make calls on, and I haven't made them, and I'm sure a consultation with the committee will make a call on dog grooming services, hairdressers and so on. How do they differentiate from a payday lender? Is that someone we wish to allow into the scheme? Certainly, I don't wish to see that. So, a lot of work to be done, I would say to the member, in the time ahead. I don't believe it will lead to any decrease on the activity of the High Street. I believe it will lead to an increase. But I'm very happy with all the stakeholders, including members, to look at how we will define in the time ahead retail and hospitality businesses and differentiate from other businesses which have benefited over the last 6 years and got a nice little lift from us to make sure that they survived through these times.
Call Mr. Gerry Mullen.
Can I thank the Minister for his statement? And I'm glad to note in your statement, Minister, that you recognise the very valuable contributions that charity shops make to your society, in terms of attracting shoppers onto our high street, and the very valuable work that they do in terms of supporting those most marginalised and most vulnerable in society. And you do intend to carry out further consultations on this matter. Can you, give me some idea as to what kind of consultations you have already carried out and what extent and what length of consultations you intend to carry on in the future, because this is a very, very big issue in terms of charity shops in my area.
And I thank the member, and you've brought this issue up before as well, and we will move into consultation on all these measures, and we'll move in rapidly into consultation. I hope many of these issues will move in before Christmas into consultation. I don't think we'll take anything forward before thrashing it out among ourselves. If you ask me how I mind it, do I believe that charity shops could pay 10%? I do. That's my thoughts on it. But I'm happy to be informed by members. As you know, it's 20% in Wales, Scotland and England. I certainly don't believe it should be any more than that. But I do believe we have to stop the proliferation. We have around just over 350. I think we're okay where we are. I certainly don't want to see more. Could they make a small contribution, maybe £15 a week? I believe, yes, they could, but I'm happy to discuss it with yourself in the time ahead and see where it goes. But this is another little idea which I know the member will be interested in. Could we use that money with the third sector, with the charity sector, to encourage social entrepreneurship, or third sector entrepreneurship, so people are trying to find other ways to raise money for foundry groups and for charities? And that would be my view. It would only be a small amount of money we'd raise through this. But the final thing is that when we went out and we asked in the consultation, which was into the small business rate relief scheme, business people had a principle which I agree with, which is everybody should pay something. So if you're on the high street, you should pay something. And that is my opinion. I don't think it has to be an awful lot, but I do think in principle everybody should pay something. I just think the last thing I would say to the member, it doesn't affect your constituency. But the higher value units which are sometimes being let to charities, say with a £100,000 annual rent being let to a charity, which means the landlord dodges responsibility for paying empty property rent, I think that's certainly an area we could tackle. I think there's a much more sympathy for the towns and villages where charity shops are a key part of the mix. So I look forward to working with you in the time ahead. There will be plenty of opportunity through committee, through the Assembly and through the consultation to make views heard. And it was a vigorous debate the last time. I'm sure it will be again.
Call Ms. Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the Minister for his answers and for his statement so far. Just following on from the previous question there, the Minister has highlighted a direction of travel in respect of charity shops, which would see a reduction in the exemption to 90%. And I fully understand the need to have a balance within our town centres in particular, thinking of the likes of Antrim, even in South Antrim. But just for clarity, will the Minister be consulting with the charity sector to include their views in any consultation?
I could go farther than that. Not only will we be consulting with them, but I can assure you I can't do this without the support of the members. So that's where I'm minded to go. I will be informed by the consultation, but it will be the members of this House who decide if we, in the time ahead, introduce any rates for high street charities.
I call Mr. Trevor Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his statement. It's encouraging to hear a Minister saying he's going to stop faffing around and take some hard decisions, so I welcome that. I'm still on charity shops, Minister. Is the Minister minded as part of the consultation to actually examine what constitutes a charity shop? Because some of the current charity shops, and I have no wish to put the boot into them, but some of them are acting in direct competition with fully-fledged shops who are paying fully-fledged rates. And I think somewhere along the line, he talks in terms of balance and a constructive approach, But I question in terms of procurement of stock and the way they operate, whether some of them actually are what was meant to be a charity shop at the beginning of all this.
Well, thank you. And yes, I think we do need to look at that. It needs to be a fair system. I've just noticed we have a large group in from Collybackie, I think. I guess of Robin Swan. I hope this is going to help villages as well. But in Lisburn, I know that charity shops are part of the mix. But I also know that it's the opinion of the charity leaders I meet, charity sector leaders and businesses, that they should not be directly competing by selling new retail items from the shops. There needs to be, we need to get the balance right. If someone is paying full rates next door to a shop, it's our understanding it should be selling goods which are not in direct competition. I think that breaches the spirit of what we're trying to do with charity shops. But let's look at it as we move forward. We shouldn't exaggerate it either. Trevor, I'm not sure that 10% is really is a stern or tough action. But I think it's a positive action in my view, in that we're saying, look, you're occupying a productive asset. We think you should make a contribution. Just one last point. There are unscrupulous landlords who dodge the empty property rate relief by putting a charity in the shop, but they don't reduce the rent by one penny. I am amazed at charities across this town who are paying full price for the properties they occupy, because I always thought the landlord had made people a deal. In fact, what the landlord does is he or she dodges the 50% empty property rate and then makes sure charities, sometimes who maybe aren't as ruthless in negotiating as some other people might be, make sure the charities pay absolute full rent. And for me, that also breaches the spirit of what we're trying to do.
Call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I think there's many good things in this statement, and I want to put that on the record. The use of pilots, the proposal in respect of energy efficient new homes, the tourism and hospitality interventions, and other things as well. But could I ask the Minister, does he not have two concerns? The first is that if it were to transpire in the near future that regeneration powers were not to be transferred to councils, that his high street interventions, of which there are a number, that the rug has been pulled from under his feet by that decision, if that decision were to be made? And secondly, does he have a concern that the DUP have flagged up very clearly this morning that when it comes to some, at least, of what he's proposing, he does not have political cover from them in that regard?
Well, I'm not going to speak for the SDLP. I'm certainly not going to speak for the DUP either this morning. I'm going to take and bank the positive comments at the start of that statement about the elements of this that you like. I'm with you in terms of regeneration powers for local councils. At the same time, and I know you will see this as well, I'm buoyed up by the attitude of councils who, as you know, do feel hamstrung. And you heard Jerry Miller on in the TV piece, the radio piece this week or last week, saying about how he believed that additional regeneration powers, Jerry Miller of Belfast City Council, would help them do more. But I don't see their hands completely tied. I see them still trying to do things. I admire the leadership of John Kelpie and Derry Strabane, the leadership of Suzanne Wiley in Belfast, and their colleagues, Castlereagh, Lisburn, or other areas who have been in touch with me. And I hope this will empower them while we wait, as Trevor Lund says, we wait for government, or we wait for Godot. At the same time, this is going to empower, I believe, the councils to partner us in the time ahead and empower businesses. And you'll know, the member will know, that despite the challenges, that the bids have gone ahead, that the Cathedral Court have voted for a bid, that Belfast 1 voted for a bid. And I think they, again, as you know, they have much more ambitious powers for much more ambitious plans and hopes for the devolution of power to cities. But at the same time, they didn't sit in their hands, and I hope that he will support what we are trying to do here, which is moving positively ahead while we await further improvements in the time ahead.
Call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as a member of the other constituency that's greatly affected by the proposal, let me unequivocally welcome the removal of the rates cap. I've long argued that it is not fair that my constituents in Kilcooley Estate subsidise the rates of those who own estates in Caltraw. Can I ask the Minister, he has said he is confident going forward in his proposals. Given the position of parties on this issue in the past, what evidence does he that he should have confidence that he will get political support from the DUP for this positive move?
Well, a second person who wants me to join the DUP and speak for the DUP. I'm very confident we will get this entire package through, and it is a package. It shouldn't be seen as, well, we're going to do something around low carbon or zero carbon homes, and which should never have been stopped, Mr. Agnew. It should never have been stopped. We're trying to bring that back. It's not only around the conundrum of empty factories. It's not only around increased help for hospitality. It is a package, and the cap is part of that package. And I'm confident that all the measures outlined today will go through and will be passed by this Assembly. Will they be tweaked? Will there be, maybe from yourself, better ideas of how we can do them? I'm open to that, and I welcome that. But I'm confident that this package of measures, as a package, will be endorsed by this Assembly in the time ahead.
Call Mr. Jim Mollister.
Bring the Minister back to the small business empowerment zones. And can I express disappointment that his approach on pivots is so Belfast-centric, and that there is not a single rural town included where the issues may be slightly different and the pivot may be beneficial there too. I think of a town like Ballymoney, ravaged by dereliction. But on the small business empowerment zone, what does it actually mean? There's no substance here about what it means. Is it rates exemption? So could he clarify that? And on rural issues, could he confirm that he's not minded to disturb agricultural rates? Can that be taken as a given?
Well, to take the third question last, yes, there will be no change to the agricultural rate reliefs. In terms of rural areas, I would welcome, Mr. Allis, if you want to bring forward suggestions to my department, to Mr. Brian McClure. There is another member here who, with whom I have discussed some rural areas, whose responsibility for rural areas, and I think it would be nice to have another pilot for rural areas outside Belfast. We may do that in the time ahead. This was the bite of this particular issue we could take at this time, but I did mention in my comments the need to do something for smaller towns and villages. And I wasn't actually thinking of a place as big as Ballymoney, but I'm thinking of, you know, some of the small coastal villages, for example, small towns. So if you have any suggestions on that, please bring them forward. You should not think that because we have one pilot, we can't have another pilot. I envisage a rates empowerment zone as being somewhere where, for example, the pioneers, the champions of the East Belfast Partnership Board, the Eastside Orchard, tonight are opening C.S. Lewis Square. They could go to a potential investor and say, we now have a special status under the rate system, that if you have a new business here, you would have 50% rate relief. Instead of paying 100%, you would pay 50% rate relief. I would like to say that that's for at least 3 years, but perhaps 5 years, so you have a bit of certainty. You have a reason to attract someone into the area. But also to existing businesses, we need you to expand. We need you to invest more. We want to really transform the area in which you're based. So it doesn't work if it's just a piece of legislation that's passed. It does work if, for example, we had a full-time worker, almost like someone who would be the chair of a bid, or the chief executive of a bid, who's going out there and selling the advantages of an area and working what's the best strategy to build in this. So it's another tool in the toolbox for, in my view, for example, the East Belfast Partnership, for the West Belfast Partnership, for the West Belfast Fela and Fubble, for East Side Arts and other groups. And I hope in that context we will move swiftly into discussions with some of the other departments about how, and the Council, how they can come in behind this idea.
Call Ms. Katrina Ruan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I welcome the statement, and if he's looking for a rural town, Warren Point will be very open to having it. Can I ask the Minister to outline more detail on his interesting proposal to enable companies to access rates relief by accrediting with the Living Wage Foundation? Because I think in all this, workers' rights are very important.
Yeah. Well, Gurmoyers and Kesh, Tug my Kurcher, Rindle Gulleroo, Yarn Amalov, Sulung Gumay Mirish, Bitter Lejas Gale, Mas Fager, Actasimu Gudjui Shaw, Leshen Counter. I have been to Warren Point, the invitation of the member, and like all the other areas out there, the towns and villages and cities, I believe this will benefit Warren Point, especially now that it's really trying to focus more on tourism in the time ahead. A really major, and I know I'm trying your patience, Mr. Speaker, because I've been on my feet too long, but a really major change in the new rates relief proposals we are making here is that people have to apply. Previously, under the spray and pray, we just said every business under a certain NAV would get relief. Now we're saying it's targeted on small retail and hospitality. But as well as that, you have to apply. It's going to be a very simple application process, but you have to prove that you've made an investment in your business. So if your rate relief is £1,000, you need to show us that you spent £1,000 on new equipment, that you spent £1,000 on skills training, that you employed more staff. I want to make it really simple, online only, but for the first time you'll have to ask for the rates relief, and that's the sea change in my mind, because now people will understand that they're earning stuff and they're entitled to it, but they have to ask for it. But one other way of, in my view, of a business being entitled to the new business rates relief system would be if it was accredited with the Living Wage Foundation. Now, this is the Living Wage Foundation, of course, accredits businesses. The new living wage is £8.45, but businesses that pay that can have the proud boast that they are Living Wage Foundation companies. And for me, any small business, retail or hospitality that could say to us, I won this accreditation, that for me would be enough to entitle them to ask for and receive the rates relief. And I do hope that encourages more companies to look seriously at how they can increase the money they pay for their staff. Of course, when you have the added investment in staff, you will be demanding more productivity, but all that moves people up the business and job value chain. So this relationship, and I know my officials are speaking with the Living Wage Foundation people today, I think this relationship can only benefit both business and employees in the time ahead.
Call Mr. Jonathan Bell.
There are a number of very positive things in the statement. I think the manufacturing industry will be hugely pleased, and rightly so, with the nature of the maintenance of industrial derating. But can I turn to paragraph 8 of the statement? And there will be interest in the use of the rate system being used to encourage regeneration, to encourage investment, and to encourage entrepreneurship. Can I ask the Minister, what measures can we use and what time frame can we use to check if this statement actually matches up to? What targets can we use in terms of an outcomes-based approach? When can we look back to see just how well we are doing at using the rate system for regeneration, investment and entrepreneurship, please?
Well, I think that's a fair question. As you know, we really didn't do that with the last scheme, but it was in the mouth and the maw of a terrible economic crisis. And I do think with this scheme, it needs to be evaluated. Maybe every 2 years we need to go back, certainly no longer than that. I think you'll agree, as former Minister for the Economy, the work you did with Neil Gibson's Economic Policy Unit, that they do good work. We're happy with the work they do. We are commissioning them, as I said, in some other areas, and I'd be very happy if they were the body that was commissioned. We can't rely on anecdotal evidence. I do think we need to assess, is this working? If it's not working, we need to do something else. I'm confident it will work. As you know, some stakeholders are very supportive, some not so supportive. But we need to get it right, and if we don't have the evidence, then we don't really know what we're doing. So I'm in favour and happy to work through with the member how we gather evidence, how we decide is it having the desired effect, that it doesn't have effects we don't want to see, and then how we can augment and enhance what's working well for us, and things that aren't working we can abandon.
Call Ms. Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister so far for his statement. Just to take him back to page 4 of the announcement today to halls of residence, while there's only one halls of residence, very small halls of residence in my constituency with Queen's University Marine Biology Station, I want to take him to ask really what impact this change will have on the very hard work that's being done to try to attract external students to come to Belfast and to be in Belfast, because with this change, it means that may be a bit more expensive. It also means for those of us rural dwellers who want to send children or who were students ourselves, it would be much more expensive to go there for the halls of residence. And is this going to have a negative impact on places like the Holy Lands?
I thank the member for her question. No, I don't think it will have a detrimental effect on the valiant efforts of our universities to attract in people from outside this jurisdiction to study here. I think it's actually making the system fairer. Other students who live away from home do pay, and other types of accommodation, which almost are like halls of residence, we see some of those springing up across the city, people will have to pay rates. It's a small change to the system. We did consult on it. I do think it's time. I haven't spoken to my dear friends in the University of Ulster or Queen's University yet, but they do have strong cases to make around overall funding, and I'm listening to that very strongly. In terms of this, I don't think it will make any difference whatsoever to their efforts to attract students in, and I think all we're doing is we're making the system more equitable.
Call Lord Morrow.
Mr. Speaker, the Minister, in his early part of the statement, he says, "Today I am proposing a groundbreaking package of measures aimed at modernising both the domestic and commercial elements of the rating system." He then proceeds to outline a list of fairly punitive measures to those who do pay the rates. Has he anything new to say about those who don't pay the rates?
Well, Lord Morrow, you have to read past the first few pages, because much of it is about people who don't pay their rates, including landlords who at the minute are paying 50%, empty property rates going up to 75%, still way off where Scotland is, but will make a difference. It involves those who don't pay rates on empty factories and trying to get that right as well, so they're going to add to the tax base. And in many of the things we're trying to do, we're trying to bring more money in, not just for the Fermanagh OMA Council, but for all the councils, but also for government coffers. And of course, the big one we debated, and we've spent, you know, best part of 30 minutes discussing the big area of people who aren't paying at the minute are those who enjoy the property cap, the domestic property cap, and that's gone as well. So there's no doubt that some of the people who heretofore didn't make as much of a contribution as they did, they'll have to shoulder more of the burden, because we're going to make the system more fair in the time ahead. But I'm always up for listening to other proposals of how to raise more rates, because, as you know, we had a bit of a love-in when we removed rates entirely from the community and amateur sport clubs, and extended that to pigeon clubs as well. And everybody's in favour of that. Everyone's in favour of removing rates. But if Lord Morrow has other proposals around how he might bring forward other measures to raise rates, I'm certainly all ears in those as well. But make no mistake, when we finish this exercise, with the support of the House, we will have more money into government coffers, £16 million recurring each year, and £10 million into council coffers.
That concludes questions on the Minister's statement, and I call Claire.